One of the most iconic parts of the Breaking Bad extended universe of shows is the montages. While montages can often come off as kind of corny, Breaking Bad and Better Call Saul do it in a way only they can. These montages can be some of the most powerful parts of the shows. For example, take the Aimee Minera montage of Better Call Saul, wherein Kim does everything in her power to climb her way back into HHM's approval. This scene is genuinely one of the most uplifting moments of television I've ever watched. There are so many fantastic montages across these shows, ranging from Heartbreaking as Perfect Day to the upbeat fun of Street Life, but one in particular has stuck out to me and many others as very unique and memorable. Something Stupid is the 7th episode of the 4th season of Better Call Saul. The premise of this episode is that Jimmy and Kim are growing increasingly distant in their relationship as their lives go down two separate paths. Kim struggles to keep up with her steadily growing workload given by Mesa Verde, and Jimmy juggles his shady Better Call Saul business with managing his PPD. The highlight of this episode is undoubtedly the titular cold opening, which shows a split-screen montage of Jimmy and Kim's diverging lives. And that's what I want to talk about today. Something Stupid is the perfect microcosm of everything that makes Better Call Saul such a perfect show. The characters, the acting, the writing, the editing, the music, the choice of color. It captures all of these amazing elements in 5 impeccable minutes. It sets up and calls back to so much, and of course the titular song choice is beautiful. So, without further ado, let's talk about Something Stupid, which, ironically, is anything but. The episode begins with Jimmy and Kim getting ready for their days, with Jimmy giving Kim a dollop of paste on her toothbrush as they share a sink with which to brush their teeth. This has been a running joke throughout the series that symbolizes their relationship. The first time we see it is the night after the first time we see Jimmy and Kim sleep together during the event of the show. Also, notice that the two sides start desynchronized. Kim's side begins before Jimmy's, which already foreshadows that Jimmy and Kim's lives are out of sync. The song begins as the two of them get to work. Kim is moving into her office at Schweikart & Coakley, while Jimmy is passing the time bouncing a blue ball. Kim's side of the screen starts with a frame full of Mesa Verde files before panning out, which is a visual shorthand that shows that her Mesa Verde work is taking over her life. The ball that Jimmy mounts, meanwhile, is blue, which is a color often associated with Kim. To me, this indicates that, as shown before, Jimmy can't take on Kim's line of work. It's too straight-laced and by the numbers for him, which is also demonstrated in the Davis and Maine compilation, another iconic montage. The next scene follows up on the last one, with Jimmy's side starting covered by the disposable phones he's selling before him and Hewlett carry them off. This parallelism between the Mesa Verde boxes from before show that Jimmy and Kim are in their own worlds, absorbed in their own respective jobs and blocked from each other. Once again, the Mesa Verde files fill Kim's frame as Jimmy closes the mobile store so we can go solicit the drop phones. Finally, just before the music kicks into full swing, we see the names of our two leads put side by side. Kim, a professional gilded engravement, and Jimmy, a cheesy yellow name card using a fake name. Note that yellow is a superficially gold color. One last thing before moving on from this portion, there's a Mother's Day advertisement visible in the shot of Jimmy turning the sign, which gives us an idea of the time period that the montage begins in. Next we see Kim receive a trophy for the opening of a new branch of Mesa Verde, while Jimmy gets his PPD papers approved. The way Kim slides the first trophy over to add the new one, in a very indifferent fashion, indicates to me that she doesn't really feel a sense of accomplishment for these prizes, and doesn't feel fulfilled by her work with Mesa Verde. Jimmy, meanwhile, has his papers marked off in a cold and methodical way as well, which, to me, is an interesting parallel. Kim receives prizes and awards towards which she feels neutral, and Jimmy has his files approved in a very by-the-numbers and robotic way. Even though these are conceptually polar opposites, both receivers react in the same way, stolid indifference. This foreshadows Kim's gradual descent into a life of schemes and trickery that Jimmy yearns for. She's outwardly a very successful person, sure, but she doesn't really feel emotionally fulfilled by her work. This is immediately followed by a shot of Jimmy and Kim in bed, Kim clearly having a restless night of sleep and throwing her leg across Jimmy's, and then a shot of them quietly eating dinner together with Jimmy filling Kim's wine glass. Note that the division in the screen is still present even though these scenes are both individual shots, which shows their emotional distance despite being physically close to each other. The fact that in both of these shots Jimmy and Kim move through the boundary tells me that they want to be close and are trying to connect with each other, but their respective work is keeping them apart. After this, we see another teeth brushing, this time starting with just Kim on her own on the left side, and Jimmy entering on his own on the right later. Again, Kim starts first. This could just be read as her needing to start earlier because she has so much to manage in terms of Mesa Verde business, or it could foreshadow that she'll eventually be the one who's the first to inspire the grand scheme to end all schemes in Season 6. This shot is also the start of the quote, second act of this montage, where we see many of the shots from the first half repeated, but with the two of them drifting even further apart. Kim gets her cast removed with an almost bored look as Jimmy makes a fresh cup of juice. The juicer is later used as a symbol of Jimmy's trauma in Bad Choice Road, and it being used here once again shows the dichotomy between the two of them. Kim goes through the motions absentmindedly, even though her cast is a symbol of a scary accident that, given the situation, could have ended in a much worse way. Kim's cast removal, plus the shot of the 4th of July sale sign, also gives the impression of time passing. We then get another scene of Jimmy and Kim at their respective jobs. While Kim works on floor plans for a new Mesa Verde branch, Jimmy and Hugh will sell more drop phones. As the camera pans to beneath the table, Kim is shown squeezing a bright green stress ball. This has three meanings I could surmise. 1. She's squeezing it with the same arm that was broken before, which, paired with the removal scene from before, shows that Kim saw the cast as, like, an inconvenience that slowed down her work, if anything. 2. The pan under the table here is the same style as in Season 2 when her and Jimmy would play footsie under the table at HHM, which leads nicely into 3. The ball is the same color as Jimmy's jacket here, which indicates that Jimmy allows Kim to de-stress. The ball and the camera angle show that she yearns for him and the simpler times they could have together, when she can unwind and forget about the strict, by-the-numbers stress of Mesa Verde. But with Jimmy equally absorbed in his work and by proxy blurring the lines between Jimmy McGill and Saul Goodman more and more, that's not an option for Kim. So instead, she copes with her loneliness by taking on pro bono cases at the Albuquerque courthouse. Notice that all of her outfits here contain an element of blue, which is the visual shorthand telling us that she's trying to connect with her roots that made her love practicing law to begin with. Blue is the color that's tied to the main legal characters in the show, such as Howard, Kim, and Chuck. Jimmy, meanwhile, is shown eating lunch with Huel, which I just think is sweet. We rarely see Jimmy with any companionship besides Kim in Better Call Saul, so it's sweet to see him connect with someone besides her. Kim receives another trophy and indifferently puts it up, another reminder of her backbreaking workload, and Jimmy completes another session of PPD. We're then shown more parallels to the first act. Now, Jimmy and Kim are both resting, but not even in the same frame. And when they go to eat dinner together, both of them are busy at work and not even acknowledging each other's presences. No wine refills or gentle nudges this time. Notably, the shots also pass by faster than the initial ones, which shows that at this point they're just going through the motions. Each day blends into the next, and neither of them are stopping to appreciate the sweet little things they do for each other, like fill up the wine glass or make juice in the morning. Brushing their teeth again, but now the shots aren't facing each other, as opposed to the other shots where both shots were slightly angled towards each other. Finally, as Kim receives her final Mesa Verde award and Jimmy finishes his PPD, we're shown one final shot of the two of them apart. Kim with her working a late night at Mesa Verde with the blinds invoking imagery of prison bars, and Jimmy eating a lonely dinner before feeding his fish. Notice how the shots aren't reversed here and the cameras aren't facing each other, and also notice the parallel imagery between the box of Mesa Verde files and the fish tank. The fish are a symbol of Jimmy's internal goodness. Take the scene where Lalo and Kim face off in their apartment. Lalo taps on the fish tank, Jimmy tells him not to, but he continues to harass them before Kim stands up and tells off Lalo. It's funny, Jimmy has hardly any qualms with carting around cartel drug money, but he cares for these little creatures so delicately. The Mesa Verde box, meanwhile, represents Jimmy's luring of Kim into his lifestyle of trickery. Recall how he tampered with the box of Mesa Verde files in Chuck's house to win Mesa Verde back to Kim. To me, the pairing of these two symbols is more visual shorthand to show that Kim yearns for Jimmy's fun lifestyle of conning, which foreshadows the end of this episode and the beginning of the next, wherein Huel gets in trouble with the law and Kim concocts a ridiculously convoluted scheme to bail him out. When Jimmy assures her that this is the end of his scheming, she reacts in a way that surprises him.
Let's do it again.
As the song draws to a close, Kim rolls into bed with Jimmy, looking opposite each other, before Kim's side fades out and Jimmy coldly opens his eyes. Of course, I couldn't talk about the scene without talking about the titular song accompanying it. The song Something Stupid was originally written by folk musician Carson Parks and his wife, before being popularized by a rendition of the song featuring Frank and Nancy Sinatra. The cover used in Better Call Saul is performed by the Israeli duo Lola Marsh. Something Stupid isn't the first time Better Call Saul utilized unique cover songs, but it's easily one of the best for me. Something Stupid has this indescribable quality that's just attached itself to my brain. Since watching the episode in December of last year, I have not been able to stop listening to it. Every night I close my eyes and I hear Something Stupid. Every day I go to school and I listen to Something Stupid. I practice every day to find some clever lines to say to make the meaning come through. Granted, having constant thoughts of Something Stupid isn't very different to my life before, but now it's the song. Ha ha. But I digress. Let's look at the actual song as it applies to this scene. The lyrics of the song are about a couple struggling to communicate their feelings with each other. They each want to come up with clever lines to charm each other and try to set up perfect scenarios before realizing that something as simple as I love you is more than enough. When I first read the lyrics, I felt like they applied perfectly to Jimmy. From a straight-on perspective, Jimmy is all show. He's flashy and always trying to be the entertainer, with his goofy quotes and poses. And by contrast, Kim is the no-nonsense, straight-laced business lady with her shit put together. While we as the audience know this isn't entirely true, as it pertains to the song, these lyrics do apply to Jimmy. One of Jimmy's main conflicts throughout the show is wanting people to be proud of him, be it Chuck, Kim, or Howard, and he feels the need to put on these grand displays to prove himself. Think of the billboard incident from season 1. So he feels the need to use clever quips or do these things to make Kim proud. Hell, this is even seen in the finale when he finally sheds Saul Goodman and gets Kim to see it himself. But he doesn't need these elaborate shows for Kim. Something as simple as a shared smoke or a shared drink or I love you is enough for her. Well, I say that, but there's a very bitter irony to the song choice here. Then I go and spoil it all by saying something stupid is actually deeply tragic when you realize there's only one time throughout the whole show when Jimmy and Kim say the words I love you.
I love you. I love you too. But so what?
Oh my god, it tears me apart every time. Just, like, who thinks this far ahead? Every single little detail in the show is so meaningful and deliberate, and there's always something new you'll pick up on a rewatch. It's so heartbreaking that when Jimmy finally drops the pretense and doesn't bend over backwards pulling schemes to try and impress Kim, and just tells her, I love you, it's too late. But that's enough about the lyrics, let's talk about the actual composition. If you watch the scene with headphones or surround sound speakers, you might have noticed that the left channel plays the woman's voice, and the right channel plays the man's voice. There's not much analysis to be done here, Kim is on the left and Jimmy's on the right, but I thought it was a nice touch worth noting. Another thing I noticed is that in the Spotify version, there's this brief transitional part between the second instance of the chorus and the instrumental part, which is omitted in the show. This might have been a change made for the sake of time, which is probably most likely, but also it makes the scene feel more rushed to me. While this pauses a moment to breathe between both parts of the song, the show version has it go straight from one part to the next. It reflects the rushed feeling of Jimmy and Kim as they go from one day to the next, one Mesa Verde branch into another, one new client after the other. I'm probably just brain rotted from listening to the Spotify version so much, but yeah. I've stretched this topic thin, but of course there is one more major thing to mention, and that's Bad Choice Road. The second to final episode of Season 5's Cold Open is a callback to Something Stupid that utilizes a soft, instrumental version of the original song. This episode immediately follows up on the previous one, Bagman, wherein Jimmy and Mike get stranded in the desert after a cartel shootout and have to find their way back to civilization. Kim, meanwhile, has no idea where Jimmy is and is trying to find information on what he was doing. So I'm going to conclude this video with a mini-analysis of Bad Choice Road's Cold Open. This cold open gives us another split-screen montage, with Jimmy and Mike hiking through the desert as Kim suffers through her mourning, Jimmy's absence weighing on her. Kim lights a cigarette, but this time she has no Jimmy to share it with, one of their signature bonding rituals. While Kim rinses her face, we see Jimmy wipe the sweat off his own sunburnt skin, which parallels this shot of the two brushing their teeth in Something Stupid. As Kim sips a glass of water, Kim begrudgingly drinks his own pee. Yo. But finally, as Kim nervously paces around the apartment, the song is cut short by the sound of Jimmy getting service. Kim receives his call and breaks down into tears as her husband ensures her that he's okay. God, this scene gets me so worked up every damn time. Despite the soft and sweet song indicating hope, the anxiety is tangible. If you've ever lived in the desert, you can practically feel the blistering heat that Jimmy suffers through, and by contrast, Kim's side feels cold and lifeless, something we see later. The lights are out and the colors are bland and washed out. Without Jimmy, Kim feels like her life is hollow and lacking in excitement. Bad Choice Road's intro builds beautifully on Something Stupid, and is definitely my runner-up for my favorite scene in Better Call Saul. As I saw one clever YouTube commenter point out, Something Stupid shows Jimmy and Kim physically nearby but emotionally distant, whereas Bad Choice Road shows them when they're physically miles apart but emotionally closer than ever. Wow, so much in just 5 short minutes. It's really a testament to how Better Call Saul makes every second of its screen time count. Nothing is irrelevant, and every detail is meticulously selected to be of importance. I'm currently in the process of rewatching the show, and it's such a rewarding show to go back and rewatch. Like, in the first episode, he says,
yeah, sure, fine. Perfect day to a perfect day.
See, guys, wait.
And all the way later in Season 6, that song is utilized at the opening montage of Fun and Games. Like, I thought the I Love You reference was impressive, but that's a whole nother level of insane. Something Stupid is really the epitome of that, and really the epitome of everything great about this show. The editing, acting, music, writing, nobody is doing it like Saul. Thank you all for watching. I know this is fairly different from the things I usually talk about on this channel, but you know what? It's my channel and I'll talk about what I want to. If you enjoyed this video, please go ahead and give it a like, maybe leave me a comment and provide your own insight, and you might not want to subscribe because I'm usually talking about like Five Nights at Freddy's or whatever, but you know, if those pique your interest too, then go ahead and check those out. My next video should actually be FNAF related, so look forward to that if you're here for my usual FNAF content. But with all that being said, I think that's about the end of this video. As usual, thanks so much for watching all the way to the end. It means so much to me that you care enough about my inane ramblings to listen to me for this long. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you all in the next one. Bye-bye!